Hey guys, welcome back to my channel. In today's video, I'm going to discuss top 10 Java important interview questions along with answers. So guys, I have already created a playlist for Java interview question series with answer. So and these are the videos available in my playlist. You can certainly go and watch these videos. Okay, now let's discuss next top 10 questions of Java interview series. So here is the question number 1. What are the 4 main features of OOPs in Java? So this is going to be one of the common questions which have been asked. So as we know, Java is object oriented programming language, and the purpose of it is what? To improve the code reusability and readability. This is what the main purpose of object oriented programming language. And there are 4 basic principles which are followed in object oriented programming language. They are known as abstraction, encapsulation, inheritance and polymorphism. You take any programming language, this 4 feature are going to be definitely there, and using this feature we implement our real life programs. Okay, what is abstraction? Whenever you want to hide internal details and you want to show only the main functionality, then that concept is known as abstraction. So for example, suppose there is a box, a black box, inside that some things are kept. Okay, so the things which are kept inside the box are not visible. So I will say that the things are hidden. For example, if you are using any function mat.sqrt, do you know how that sqrt function has been built? You only know the syntax of using it. So what is happening, the programmer is least bothered about the internal detail of that particular function, how it has been developed. The job of programmer is to use it. Okay, so we can do that through the concept known as abstraction. Another concept we have known as encapsulation, binding of data or code together into a single unit is known as encapsulation. Like if you see this capsules, so capsule, there are 2 or 3 colors capsules. In that we have what? Something what? Binded together. So this is something else and this is something else, and they both together make what? Your capsule. Okay, so same thing is happening over here. We are having code and we are having data. We are binding together into a single unit. Okay, another concept which is again a popular concept used in object oriented programming known as inheritance. So inheritance is nothing but acquiring property or behavior of parent class or one class. Okay, so from the class which we acquire the property, they are called as parent class, and the class which will be acquiring the property is known as child class or superclass and subclass. Okay, so inheritance is one of the important feature. The purpose of inheritance is reusability. If you have created one class, you can make a child class of that and you can reuse the parent class. Okay, so another feature is what? Polymorphism in object oriented. So polymorphism is what? The meaning of polymorphism, it is made up of 2 word, poly and morphs. So poly means many and morphs means form. So one task is performed in different way, so that is known as morphs. So for example, I am writing some function. Okay, so in Java how we do polymorphism? So by writing what? Method overloading and method overriding. Okay, so I'm writing sum function. So here my sum function is taking 2 parameter of type integer. Here my sum function is taking what? 2 parameter of type float or 3 parameter of type float or double. So they are what? I will call them as polymorphism. Why? Because the functionality it is going to perform as sum only, but here the parameters are differing, that hence I will call them as what? Polymorphism. Okay, so there will be a parent class and there will be a child class. So child class may change body of this method which is there in parent class. That is again a concept comes under polymorphism. So overriding and overloading is a part of polymorphism. Okay, now question number 2, what is an abstract class? So whenever a class contain abstract method, we call it as abstract class. So first of all, what is abstract method? Abstract method is a method which does not have a body. So you can see here, I'm having a draw method, but this draw method is not having body. So I will call it as abstract method. So before the method name, I'm going to use one keyword known as abstract. So now the question comes, what is abstract class? So a class which contains at least one abstract method is going to be a abstract class. So at least once means what? One method or more than one method, and that is abstract. At least one abstract method should be there, so that class become abstract class. So if a class question arises, if we are not writing body of this method, what is use of it? So what will happen if I'm doing inheritance of this class? Then what will happen? The derived class can override body of this draw method. Okay, another property about abstract class is that we cannot instantiate it, right? Creation of object is not possible when we are inheriting abstract class. Abstract class can contain only abstract method. Java allows abstract method in abstract class, while for other language it allows non-abstract method as well. Okay, so this is about abstract class. Now next is what is final keyword in Java? So there are three places where we can use final keyword. One we can use with variable, one we can use with method, and one we can use with what? Class. Okay, so whenever I am using a final keyword with variable, then what will happen? That variable will become what? Constant. That means if you have declared variable using final keyword, and if you have assigned some value to it, later on if you try to reassign value to this variable, here I have variable constval and I have assigned 100 to it. Later on if I am writing constval somewhere in my program equal to 200, then I am going to get error because I have declared my variable of type final, and final means what? The value cannot be reassigned or cannot be changed. So the first purpose is what? Declaration of variable as a constant. You can use final keyword. Now the second purpose, if you are using a final keyword with method, then you cannot override this method. What is overriding? Nothing but subclass will have freedom to change body of what method which is there in parent class. So if you use final keyword before any method, then that method cannot be overridden, means the derived class cannot change body of the method which is there in parent class. Okay. So this method are faster than any other method because they are resolved at compile time. So remember, whenever you are declaring any method using final keyword, so they are resolved during compile time. It does not wait for runtime. So hence they are faster. Now the third uses of final keyword is what? With class. So if you are using final keyword with class, then the class will become what? Final, and then what will happen? You cannot do inheritance of that class, so it cannot be subclass. So if you want to not allow anyone to inherit your class, then declare that class as what? Final class. So variable declared with final, it becomes constant. Method, if you declare with final keyword, then you cannot override. Class, if you declare final, you cannot inheritance. Okay, I hope you understood. Now let's go to question number 4. What is the purpose of static variable and static method in Java? So static concept is again important in Java. So static variable and static method. So let me tell you one scenario. For example, I'm declaring one class, and in that class, the class is for student, and suppose all student belongs to the same college. So what will happen if I'm having one variable known as what college name, and if I am having total 100 students, so rather than creating the college name variable for 100 students, what I can do, I can declare that variable as static variable, because the students, 100 students belong to same college, so the college name will not change. So rather than storing 100 values for college name, I can store it only once. I can share that college name with all other 100 students. Okay. So whenever you want to share value of your variable, then you can use what static keyword before your variable name. So when there is a need to share a variable or a method between multiple objects of a class, rather than creating separate copies for each, what we can do, we can create the variable with a static method. So if you are creating variable with a static method, then only one copy of that variable is created. Hence, static keyword is also used for memory management, because if you are creating 100 object of that class, so 100 copy is not created if you declare any variable of type static. Only one copy is created. So if anyone is doing changes to that variable, the changes will be what reflected to other objects also. Okay, hope you understood. Now the next question is what, how we can pass arguments to a function by reference instead of pass by value. As in computer science or in programming language, we know the value can be passed by reference or pass by value, but in Java we can pass the argument only by value and not by reference. Okay, so if you see example of other programming language like C, C++, there we have the concept of pass by reference also. Now the next question, why Java is not 100% object oriented? Just now we have seen definition of object oriented. Java is object oriented, but it is not 100% object oriented. The reason behind that, like we use different data types such as boolean, byte, char, int, float, long, double, and they are not object, they are primitive data types. Okay, so hence we can't say Java is 100% object oriented. Okay, now question number 7, is string a data type in Java? So string is a data type, but it's not a primitive data type, it's a reference data type. Okay, so when you are creating a string, then actually an object of java.lang.string is created, and after the creation of this object, you can use all the built-in methods of this string class. So string is a class, is a whenever you declare variable of type string, the reference type is created, not the primitive type is created. Now question number 8, what are the wrapper classes in Java? So wrapper classes convert the primitive data type into the reference type. So what will happen if you create primitive data or convert primitive data type into reference data type? You can use the methods of that class, reference class. So whatever data type we are having in Java, for all data type we are having their corresponding wrapper classes. For example, for int data type we have integer class. Okay, for byte, small byte data type, so there is an integer class for int data type. And if you have a byte variable, then there is a byte class, and B will be in capital because it is a class, so here we will be having byte class, right? So what will happen then? So these are the classes. As you know, classes have methods, so we can use methods of this class. Okay, so that is nothing but wrapper class. So these are known as wrapper class because they wrap the primitive data into an object of a class, and since it is wrap, you can use methods of it. Question number 9, why pointers are not used in Java? So there is no concept of pointer in point There is no, so question number 9, why pointers are not used in Java? So there is no concept of pointers unlike your C or C++ in Java because they are unsafe. Okay, memory can be accessed using pointers. So Java does not allow pointers for the security purpose as they are unsafe. And pointers increases what complexity of the program. If you are C or C++ programmer, you know how complex pointer programs are. Okay, now the last question, 10th question, how objects of a class are created if no constructor is defined in a class? So if you have not declared any constructor in your class, so how the classes or objects are created? Yes, objects are created because if you don't define any explicit constructor in our class, then Java automatically adds one implicit constructor in class, and that implicit constructor will not have any parameter. So if in your class you are not having any constructor, but by default there will be one constructor, that is what implicit constructor if you don't write any other constructor. Okay, so these were the 10 questions. I hope you enjoyed these questions and you like the questions also. So guys, that's all for this video. I hope you like the video. If yes, then do hit on like button, and if you have any query, you can put in comment box. I will surely reply to your queries. And guys, if you are new to my channel, please subscribe to my channel and don't forget to press bell icon to receive notifications from my channel. And guys, I have given a link of my Telegram channel in description box. You can join that if you want free PDF and notes. Okay, thank you guys for watching my video till end. I'll see you in my next video. Till that, bye bye and take care.